Today's talk will be focused on giving you an insight on the rules of thumb used in structural design. To give us this talk, we have with us Mr. Hemanth Gore, who is a structural engineer with over 20 years of experience in the field. To give you a little background about him, since graduating from IIT, one of the most prestigious universities in India, he went on to work with some of the biggest firms in Russia, Singapore, the UK, and currently is the principal structural engineer for Petrofac International Limited. He's also a very active member of the Ishrakti regional group, and he's given over 40 technical talks to both students and professionals. So without much further ado, I'd like to welcome Mr. Hemanth. Hemanth, thank you for coming today.
Thank you, Sirin, for that introduction.
Anytime, our pleasure.
Yes.
Before you start, just a quick note to the attendees. If you have any questions through the way, please do post them using the Q&A feature of Zoom. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, young members. Today, I will share 5 topics with you, which will help you when you begin your career in design firm. It will also help you to crack the most exam, Ishrakti. So we will cover approximate analysis of truss, effect of scale, rule of thumb for steel design, and as in real life, we should know who is our real enemy. If we know our real enemy, we can solve problem better. And at the end, we will touch on a principle which was given during 18th century least work principle for truss optimization. And bonus, I will give some tips to make your thesis work easy. So let's dive into the first topic, approximate analysis. Before I begin my talk, I want to remember my 3 mentors, my teacher at IIT Bombay, who taught me structural engineering. And he told me, always take new challenge and remember one thing, you will remain student always. My first mentor, C.R. Alim Chandani, who received world's best structural engineer award. William Bill Baker, I have never met him, but his talk inspired me. And one time I said one of my presentation and he gave a good work done. So I will remember my 3 mentors. In real life, when we have to do a complex structure analysis, it is always good to convert that problem into a simple problem. This slide shows a truss which has to carry a load. If I have to do quick analysis, what will be the size of top cord and bottom cord member required? The quick process will be calculate what is the total load over length. So we are converting a point load into uniformly distributed load. And we know for a simply supported beam, the bending moment at the center is WL square over 8. Once we know the moment, it is taken by push-pull between top and bottom cord. So we can find the force in the bottom cord and top cord. And once we know force, we can decide on a cross-section required based on allowable stress. So here, instead of doing a 3D or 2D computer analysis or method of joint, method of section, we found what will be the section required for a truss. And to size our diagonal, we can calculate reaction at the support. And if force is F and theta, F sine theta equals to the reaction, and we can find the force in diagonal member. This will help us to size initial section for a complex truss. And same strategy we can use for a vertical bracing system, because like in a tower, we provide a vertical truss to take lateral load. Myron Goldsmith, a graduate from Illinois Institute of Technology during 1954, he wrote a thesis on effect of scale. What an amazing work. He connected his work with Galileo, where there was a problem of designing a pump. And one of his scholars told, like, once you have invented a first pump machine, now you can scale up, scale down for a different flow requirement. At that time, Galileo told, okay, that is not a right way, because each individual problem must be solved by a different scheme. So when we have to span 5 to 10 meters, we go for a beam. And when our problem becomes big, like 20 meter, 30 meter, the only possible solution is a truss. And what is the beauty of truss? All the fibers, they are stressed to same level. So this way, like we can correlate with the football team where all the 10 players are performing to win the match. And in case of a beam, only top fiber and bottom fiber are getting stressed. So whenever we have a problem of a big, we go for a structural steam, structural system where forces will be transferred through push and pull. Here we have one more example of a bridge. When we want to span more than 400 meters, we go for cable stay system, where cable take load by tension and a deck in compression. And when I have a span of 200 meter, we just go for a box girder bridge, which can be a balanced cantilever or a continuous bridge. In building, we use, like for a Burj Khalifa problem, the system used was buttress core, where core was stiffened by 3 wings. So this fundamental principle we should remember. Each problem will require a new solution, new thought process. We cannot just copy paste old solution. Structural design has 3 stages. We call concept design, preliminary design, and detailed design. And knowing rule of thumb will help engineer at these 3 stages. This slide shows the workflow in structural engineering. First, we have a problem, site constraint. We come up with a structural form, geometry, and then we have to size our beam, column, and bracing member. Then we run a 2D or a 3D computer simulation to find out the displacements and forces in the member. And then comes the member design. And it is always good to verify our computer analysis by rule of thumbs or a quick rule, as we saw in our first problem, like how we converted a truss into a beam. Design involves 3 limit states, limit state of strength, serviceability, and stability. When we speak about strength, we have to ensure axial, like we transfer our load from superstructure down to ground by axial compression tension, bending and shear, torsion, or combined actions. Serviceability, we perform check for deflection. When it is a water retaining structure, we perform crack width check, sway check. When we build a tall structure, then the person who is staying at the top floor, he will feel acceleration. So we have to perform check on acceleration. And when we make a bridges or a floor vibration check, stability check, overturning, sliding, lateral rocking, and uplift. Now we will jump into a steel design preliminary rule of thumbs. For steel, here in Middle East, we get European section, British, American section, and few job Japan. So European section for beam, we call as IP, universal beam for British, and American, we have W. In European, we get a same depth section with a different weight. So IPAA will be the heaviest section in that series. For column, we use HE profile. British, we use universal column. American, again W. And in Japanese section, it is named by H, B, and thickness of flange and thickness of web. The first thing comes for section to be decided, moment of inertia. Serviceability check, like, and the moment of inertia will play a crucial role in a deflection control. So moment of inertia can be calculated approximately by this formula, d square into w over 4.7. So if I know depth of the section, weight of a section in kg over meter, I can find first moment of inertia in centimeter power 4. Let's check, is this formula correct? So I took a sample beam UB457 by 74 kg. So my depth is 45 centimeter, D 45.7 centimeter, weight 74 kg. We put into that rule of thumb, depth square into weight of a section over 4.7. And moment of inertia, first moment of inertia, it came around 32,882. And actual is near about same. So this formula will help us. So when we want to just like we remember depth of a profile, weight of a profile, then quickly to find what will be the moment of inertia. We will connect this formula with our further calculation down in the presentation. Now, we will jump into column section. If I want to find out moment of inertia of a column section having lesser depth compared to universal beam, the formula becomes W square into weight over 4.4. Let us verify, does this formula give the right result? So depth 20.3 centimeter, weight 86 kg over per meter. So depth square into 86 over 4.4, 9,600, and actual is 9,400. So we are very close. I remember my professor used to tell the job of structure engineer is to give close to the right answer. We are not scientists. If we are not able to give up to the last decimal, that is okay. If our result falls within 5%, that judgment or rule of thumb is good. The second property of a section which we use for axial member is slenderness ratio, because slenderness ratio will decide its axial carrying capacity. And to calculate slenderness ratio, we need radius of gyration. And the radius of gyration can be calculated quickly. It is 41% of a depth, major radius of gyration, and minor radius of gyration 22%. And for a UC profile, it becomes 43% in a major and 25% of width in a minor axis. So this rule of thumb will help us to design axial compression members, because axial compression members, they will be governed by buckling. Here I have connected my first formula. So if I know bending moment for a beam, span of a beam and depth, I can calculate what weight of profile will be required. So we will just put bending moment, span of the beam in meter, and depth we decide by span to depth ratio. We remember like cantilever 7, simply supported beam 20, and continuous beam 26. So once you have decided, like if I have a 10 meter span beam, for span to depth ratio 20, D will become 50 centimeter. So I put these numbers into this, I will get weight of the profile required. 85 M, M will be working moment. It will not be a factored moment. Like when we do design, we calculate for factored load and unfactored load. So here M is just working moment. Now we can see one example where I took a beam of 8 meter span having a live load of 20 kilonewton per meter. My bending moment was WL square over 8, 160 kilonewton per meter. I took a beam of depth span over 20, 40 centimeter depth. I put into that magic formula 85 ml over D square. 85 m, which is a bending moment, span over depth square. And we got a section of 68 kg per meter. And I can select UB profile from a steel table. So here I have given summary. That formula, again, we did simplification. So weight for girder, the weight will be like here two formulas for truss and girder. Suppose if I want to design a truss, then what will be the weight? Now we will jump into the formula to calculate quickly deflection of the beam, because deflection will be required to make sure like our cladding, facade, they don't, being a flexible member, brittle member, they don't fail. So to perform quick deflection check, deflection equals to M L square over 10 EI. So this formula will be useful for simply supported beam, where you calculate maximum bending moment at the center working span square over 10 EI. The fifth formula which we use frequently for vibration check, as I said, sometimes when we design a floor, a staircase, we have to perform vibration. Like when we walk, our frequency is around 3 to 5 hertz. So if the beam has 3 to 5 hertz, it will fall into resonance. And like, as we know, the phenomena of like resonance, if you apply small force, it will get magnified. So to avoid resonance, we need to calculate frequency. So frequency equals to 18 over root delta, delta being deflection at the center. So this formula will give the frequency. So we touch, let me summarize all the formula which we touched. First, moment of inertia, radius of gyration. If I know bending moment 85 ml over D square, then I can find out the weight of a section required. A deflection 10 ml square over 10 EI, and finally frequency. One more quick check for 8 meter span. The deflection at the center was 9 mm. So I put 18 over under root 9, 18 over 3, 6 hertz. Now we will jump into the third topic of today, knowing your enemy. This slide shows floor plate of Burj Khalifa. For tall building, the biggest enemy is not earthquake, but wind. Because as you make a tall structure, it becomes flexible. During the early days, the formula which engineers used to remember, time period of a structure equals to 0.1 times number of story. So if I have a 100 story building, the time period of building will be 0.1 into 100, 10 seconds. So this one is a quick magical formula to remember. Like if someone says they're like 82 story building. So 82 into 0.1, its fundamental time period will be about 8.2 seconds. Here I want to show you like wind being our critical enemy. If we orient a tower along predominant wind direction, then it will like we have to configure our orientation such a way it will not like wind will not be enemy. Let me ask, like, do we have a facility to put answer in a chat box, Serene? Like, can our participant put their answers into chat box? Just, I wanted to ask question to our participants. So here I wanted to demonstrate how a wind rose diagram for a particular city. We learn in airport engineering, the wind rose diagram helps to orient airport runway. So the airport runway direction gives predominant wind direction. So Burj Khalifa was oriented along that same direction to get minimum wind force to be at the foundation level. So here, engineers connected knowledge of different field to find out most economical solution. Now, we will jump into the most interesting topic, least work principle. We learn in physics, work done equals to force into displacement. And as a structure engineer, when we want to find out work done in a structure, we use same principle. Work done equals to force into displacement. Maxwell, during 19th century, he gave a theorem. If you want to make optimum trust, most economical trust, then that trust will be having a, like it will come from situation where you have members going into tension. This blue color members, they are in a tension, and green color members, they are in compression. So what Maxwell told, you bifurcate all the tension members, compression members in two parts. Find out product of force in a tension member and length of a tension member. Do its summation. Same exercise you do with compression member. Product of force in a compression member into its length. And you have now two quantities for a tension, compression, you add it. And if this sum becomes a least, that will be the least weight trust, the most optimum trust. He didn't have any computer at that time, but he wrote this thesis, least work principle, bifurcate tension members, compression member, find a product of force in a tension member into length of a tension member, product of force in a compression member and length of a compression member, this theorem, and find out the sum. If your sum is least, that structure is doing least work. And when someone does least work, it's most optimum. Like it connects with a human. We also want to do least work and want to get more output, more productivity. So let us check like what Maxwell like wrote early days. Is it correct? And to verify, I took one exercise. I took this truss, which has to span a distance. I fixed my depth. So my span is fixed, depth is fixed. Only thing which I could play here was this point. I can move this point out or in symmetrically. Like I can move both these points out or in. So this was only variable. So when I move that point in, there will be change in A over B. When I move out, there will be change in A over B. So the final variable remains only one, A over B. So our problem is we have to take this W load at the center. Let me show this figure. I have to transfer W load from mid span to the support. My span is fixed. Depth is fixed. Depth means lever arm. That is fixed. Only the thing which I can play, I can move B point and C point simultaneously out or in, like both sides, like top we have B, E, C, F. So we can move this like inside or outside. That is only one variable. So let's run that exercise which Maxwell told, force in a tension member into its length, do summation. So to run this exercise, the variable A over B, I took three numbers. First, I took 1 point, 1 minute. Yeah, I took first value. So these were the length of our members, forces in the member. We found out product 44.07375 into 1.76 product, summation of the product. Now we will run same exercise for tension member. We found both work done same. We did with another possible ratio, same tension compression member product. And finally, we'll see summary. We did exercise with three numbers, 1.543, 1.618, 1.752. And sum came least at this number, 1.618. Do you recall this number? It has any connection with architecture or mathematics? Yes, you are correct. This we call a golden ratio. Like when architect, they design, they try to put into this golden ratio. Like our credit card, it comes with that golden ratio. If you divide this length over this, it will come 1.618. And the structure engineer who designed our body, he kept this golden ratio in our body. Like if you see this fingers, this over this part, it will come 1.618. This over this 1.618. So God was knowing, like human, they are lazy. They want to do least work. So he configured our bones part into a golden ratio. Is it amazing? Like we structure engineer, we can find like why something is happening and it's magical. Here I have shown again from a first principle how that theorem came. Work done in a truss we call F square L upon over 2AE. I broke into two parts, F over A, stress, F into L, which we were finding. And for a material 1 over E, if we are stressing all the members to straight, like allowable stress level, then this will become a constant. So force into length becomes a constant, like total force into length and total work done. We did one more exercise for a truss vertical bracing system. So we have five different configuration of truss member. And we found work done in all the five system. Work done came least in the fifth system, which had this configuration. What we did here, if this is L, this will become L over 1.618. If this is L, this is L over 1.618. So like what we found from that small example of truss. And we can see the work done here is just 21,112. And Beal Baker, SOM, when they had to design one of their structure, they use same configuration for vertical load resisting system. Now, I would recommend, if you want to take your journey as a chartered structure engineer, first step, when you are at a university, you should take certificate in structural behavior exam. This has only 20 questions. It happens on online platform. When you take up this certificate course, you can attempt infinite times on a computer different beam, continuous beam, portal frame problem for bending moment and shear force. And once you are ready, you want to go for exam. It will be a live exam. Examiner will be sitting on the other side observing you, and you put objective based answer A, B, C, D. 1 hour exam, 20 problem. And it will give you a certificate in structural behavior. And to become like this, one of the IPD objective is analysis and design. So if you have this certificate, you can pass that objective. You can demonstrate, okay, yes, you have understanding about structural behavior and design. So I strongly recommend, please attempt, go for this exam. It's a 20 question, 1 hour online. And you get opportunity to solve as many as, before going into the real exam, you can do as many attempts as on a computer. Now, I want to give a tip. We all use Google daily to find something. But what happens when you ask Google, it gives you million, billion answers. And we don't have a time to go through that many answers. So when I do search on a Google, I always give clue where to search. Like when we visit restaurant, we ask menu card, okay, please tell me which dishes you have. So here I'm telling Google, okay, I want to talk like durability concrete from university in US, Berkeley. So my results will be just narrow down to few, not millions. And if I want directly a PowerPoint presentation file, I can put one more clue, file type PPT, and my results will be further narrowed down. So this will be useful when you do your research work or when you start your career, when your boss asks, okay, because as a structure engineer, we want to read, we want to explore, but we should get information from right source, not from anything XYZ. Another application which I find useful is computers and structures who have developed SAP 2000, ETABS, SAFE. They have application for cross sections, CSI section. So you can have this application also, which is good for engineers. And as I end this talk, 3C, which will take you further: curiosity, commitment, and continuous learning. And as a structure engineer, our responsibility is to create, and to create, we have to collaborate. And whenever we collaborate, it may happen, or during course of design, we have conflict with a client or other discipline, then we try to resolve conflict. So this 3C, which has helped me in my career till date, create, collaborate, and conflict, and curiosity, commitment, continuous learning. So I quickly will summarize what we learned today. Rule of thumb to calculate moment of inertia, radius of gyration, weight of a section, how quickly we can analyze our truss by converting into a beam. And then we jumped into least work method, least work principle to find out optimum truss configuration. So now I keep floor open for question and answer session.
Thank you so much, Mr. Hemant. It was definitely a very well presented talk, and the explanations were very lucid. So let me see if I have any questions. To all the attendees, if you have any questions, please do post them using the Q&A feature of Zoom. Haven't received any yet, actually. In case they have any questions later, can you share your contact details? So,
yes. So my contact details, I will just put on a slide.
Okay. Thank you so much. Oh, we received one question.
Please.
So the question is there any rule of thumb for transfer elements?
Good. So like very good question. Like we use transfer element when we want to make a floating column. So same like our basic rule for beam girder sizing, we have to calculate bending moment and span ml square, 85 ml square over. So same rule we can use. Like these are the fundamental rule of thumb, cross section weight.
Okay,
yes, 85. So like when we have a transfer girder, we will calculate bending moment at mid span, the span of a transfer girder, 85 ml over d square. So we'll decide depth again based on span to depth ratio. And like if it's a heavy transfer girder, we go for post tension. Like the three structural material we use, concrete, reinforced concrete, structural steel, and pre-stressed concrete. So if you have a large bending moment, then we make a transfer girder using pre-stress. I didn't touch today on a pre-stressed concrete, but pre-stressed concrete, we do load balance method.
Okay, thank you so much. We have another question from Vivek. He says, seeing the truss configuration you showed as the most effective, why is a similar configuration not used more commonly?
Good. Okay, so that's a real, like a perfect question. Yes, like if something is the optimum, why till date we didn't find this configuration in real life situation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So like we use spread truss, ho and truss, and why not this one?
Exactly.
So then like it's about awareness, like where you can do optimization. Like here is a beauty, like all structure engineers, they don't win all the job. Like now most of the job we do design build. So in design build, a structural consultant who gives most economical design to contractor, he bids and then he wins the job. So when you have something to be done repetitive n number of times, then if you save quantity on a one truss, then you can win the job. So to answer, if something is not used, it does not mean it cannot be used. And like if you know the fundamentals, it will make economical. Yeah.
Okay, I hope that's clear. And Muhammad Saifuddin asks, any rule of thumb for finding zero force members in a trust?
Good question. So like we learn zero force member. Let me draw. I'm sharing my screen. I will just share from instead of PowerPoint. Desktop, I will share. Or whiteboard is okay. Whiteboard.
Sure, yeah.
So Serin, can you see whiteboard now?
Yes, it's clear.
So like zero force member, it means a member which will not take any force. So if I have okay, we can go to presentation also. We have a zero force member in a presentation. Mm-hmm. Yeah, here. So here we had this member, which was a zero force member. Like I didn't put here, but yeah. So like to find out a member, zero force. Okay, so now like at this joint we have not can you see my board, Serin?
Yes, it's clear, we can see.
Yes, so now let us come to this joint. At this joint, for like here we don't have any external force, so what will happen? As we don't have any external force, the three basic principle of statics we use, summation fx over summation fx equals to zero, summation Fy equals to zero, and summation moment equals to zero. So at this junction, we don't have any vertical force. So here summation Fy becomes zero. So this force is zero member. So when this force is zero member, this guy becomes zero member. So the force will travel from this bracing down to this. So like if you don't provide this two member, it is good. So like this is a procedure to find out a zero force member. So you go to that joint, put this two magical equation of equilibrium, summation fx zero, forces in x direction, summation of forces in y direction zero. So now if I put this thing, like here we don't have any vertical force. If I had, so here what I have assumed, Serin, self weight is not there. Like if we had a self weight, then force will go. But we have assumed self weight is not there. Mm-hmm. So this becomes zero force member. And like once this is zero force, this guy is also zero force. Because at this junction, we have summation fx zero. So both are zero. So force is traveling down to from this root down here.
Okay.
So this guy will be under compression and this column will be under tension.
Saifuddin says it's clear. Thank you for explaining that. We have one more question. Sushanka asks, does it have a bearing on the material strength? I'm not sure what the question is.
Okay, his question may be like that our least work principle. Does it have anything relates to material? Is that
material
question?
Material strength.
Yeah. So, like we have two stages in design. First, we call analysis to find out forces in the member. And once you know forces, you jump into design. So these are two separate processes. So what Maxwell gave, it has no relation with material. You can play with steel, concrete, anything. It is just says for product of force into length. You find out for tension, find out for compression. And when it is a list, you get a best structural optimized form. Like you have done your studies from TU Delft, they are also doing research in geometrical form finding, optimum structural configuration.
Okay, thank you. That's clear as well. I don't think any more questions are coming in. So I believe that's all for today.
Thank you so much.
It was a very interesting lecture.
So before I end, I would just recommend all the participants to go for structural behavior exam. It has a nominal fee. And once you pass, like you can put that certificate to get your first job. It will be considered. Like I passed and it helped me to pass chartered membership exam. So I would strongly recommend to go for this exam. And as a student, you will get a discount. You have a discount.
Thank you so much for bringing that up, actually. Both student and graduate members, if you have any more questions regarding that, please just get in touch with either the regional group or the student chapter. You can reach us on Instagram as well as LinkedIn. Just type in iStruct regional group and you'll be there. I mean, UAE. We have one more question. It says, how can I get the recording for this session? It will most probably be posted on YouTube. iStruct regional group UAE is the name of the page. Just visit us soon. And please do subscribe. Thank you. So that's all for the night. Thank you everyone for attending this talk. Thank you, Hemant, for taking your time out for this.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye.